Good morning. Good morning. Happy Mother's Day to all of you on this beautiful day as we gather together to be together and to worship our Lord together. Actually, every day is a beautiful day when we're together. Whether it's sunny outside or snowy or rainy or stormy, it's always nice to be here in one another's midst in this place. I want to especially welcome those of you who are visiting with us today. If you came today to meet our wonderful pastor, please come back next Sunday. George and Linda have been away in South Carolina. We'll talk about his brother's death a little bit later. They're traveling today and tomorrow to return. They'll be back tomorrow evening. You can come in when we sing the hymn. Choir's going to process today. Not right now, when we sing. Choir's going to process. Anyway, we're having second string with us today. So welcome. Ellen's going to preach this time. I'm leading the service. And we're just overjoyed to be together here. We're going to sing together to begin our worship hymn number 505 that Norma has already started with. And may we stand to sing together this praise to our Lord. 505. Father, we stand before you this morning with joyous hearts. We're thankful for Christian homes that we can be together in this family of Jesus Christ here at East Livingston Baptist. But we also thank you for our mothers. We thank you for all that they have meant to us. And we thank you most especially for the freedom that we enjoy to worship you as we choose. Bless our time together as we have gathered in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever. Amen. While you're standing, we're going to greet one another, but there is a rule that we're going to follow today. For the first 30 seconds, you must greet someone that you do not know. And then you can greet somebody that you know. 30 seconds, and then just a minute. No, wait, when Norma plays the music, come back together, okay?
That's wonderful.
Are you
going to
preach?
It's the song of the redeemed, rising from the ashes,
I got hair like yours.
It's the
the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon. The song of Asian believing, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, a love song born of a grateful choir.
Thank you very much. I almost got you to pay attention to the music before you broke up to greet one another, but it's a wonderful opportunity to be together and to recognize the diversity in our congregation. The choir is going to sing for us in a little while. These ladies are from all over the world, and Edwin also, and to come together in united voice to sing together is representative of our being together as the body of Christ every Sunday morning, and we're delighted that you're with us and part of us, even as you are visiting with us. There are some announcements, some information that is valuable to us, and there's some slides here. The first is food pantry collection is today. If you brought food, please do so. That goes to the Helping Hands Food Pantry Network. Second, there's a Board of Trustees coming this Tuesday evening. Those of you who are deacons, trustees can stay home this week. The deacons will come to their meeting 7 o'clock on Tuesday. Third, Wednesday is our usual Bible study at 7 o'clock on Wednesday. Then our big day is Saturday. God's Willing Workers is what we have in our bulletin. It's an opportunity for us to come and work together inside and out on our property. We represent Jesus Christ to the community, and it's important that our facility represent who we are as a community of faith. Ellen and I will be here. Probably I'm going to end up pulling ivy off the side of the building. That's been my job for 2 years. And somebody can help me do that if you want. I don't know if I'm going to get assigned to that or not, but come and find out what you want. There is a clipboard coming around for some food for lunch that day. We will gather and work and then have lunch in the fellowship hall. And if you have something you can bring, put that on the form. If nobody signs up with food, then we'll just work. Maybe we'll have coffee on or something. That'll be all right. Next Sunday is a very special day because it's Youth Sunday, and the young people are going to be leading us in our worship service. It's always good to have our young people visible before us, and our children as well. I may have the children come up in a few minutes, also those that are here today. That's next Sunday, so be sure to come. And then on June 4th is graduation Sunday, and we want to recognize all of those who have graduated, who are part of our church family. Okay, any other announcements that need to be made this morning? Let us then take the responsive reading you'll find in your bulletin. And this is an opportunity for us to recognize mothers. And we're going to do something a little bit different after this reading, but this is a litany for us in honor and celebration of those who are mothers in our midst and who are connected to us in a wider world around us. As we share responsively, mothers come in many different forms, and today we celebrate them all.
Thank God for mothers.
Everyone here is either a son or a daughter.
Thank God for our mothers.
For those women whom we miss on earth.
Thank God for the mothers of the past.
For every woman who is working right now to raise her children. For all the women who are expecting but aren't mothers yet.
Thank God for soon to be mothers.
For the women who took in others' children through adoption and foster care.
Thank God for mothers with big hearts.
For those women who have lost a child to death and must carry on.
Thank God for the mothers who are so strong.
For all the women who, though not have birthed children, have chosen to mother others.
Thank God for those who are mothers in spirit.
We thank you, Lord, for all the women who have influenced our lives in so many ways. We honor them today and lift our hearts before you in thanksgiving. I'm going to ask now for the children to come forward. Just come on up here. Your kids are going to go away. Excuse me. Children are going to go away in a couple of minutes to children's church. But I want you to come up here. Is what? Oh, that's okay. Yeah. Thank you very much. You think I was going to pull that cord over? I wasn't going to go very far with it. Come on up here, kids. Come on. We typically have 10 or 12 young children. Come on, stand up here on the platform with me, will you? You all look so great. Come on over. Come on up here. You look so great. Now, I want to let you know these are not the church of the future. These are the church of the present. And they're very much a part of our congregational life. We usually see you guys when you're leaving for junior church, so we only see the back of you, but we want everybody to see the front of you today and see what a wonderful collection of children this is. Now, here's what I'd like you to do. Do you know how to clap?
Mm-mm.
Clap your hands together? Can you do that? Okay, just a minute. Okay, we'll practice that in just a second. I would like to have all of our mothers stand. Those of you who are mothers, have been mothers. I guess if you have been a mother, you're still a mother. We want to honor you today on this special day. And I want you kids, this is sort of a demonstration of how many mothers are in our congregation by the number of kids we have. Can you give all of our mothers a big clap hand? Let's do that. You can smile when you do that. These are your mothers we're thanking today. Now, while you're standing, I'd like all the other women to stand also. Whether you're not, it's okay if you're not a mother, you're a woman and part of motherhood that so influences our church and our world. We have a carnation for each of you today. Now, I'm going to ask you children, come down here and carefully take two or three of these carnations and take them to the women who are standing. And as soon as you get one, you may be seated. If you want to know what you can do with these carnations, when you hold them during the service, just stick them in the communion cup holder. That's okay. All right, now go and take them to somebody who's standing, and watch out for the drips on here, okay? And there's some over on the other side, too. You can go and get some from the other side. And if you need more, come back and get them, okay? There, take that. Take all of those. Can you get them? That's good.
Okay.
There. All right. Can you take all of those? Those are a big handful. Come on over here. Here's some more. Here's some more. Make sure everybody gets one who's standing up. And when they sit back down, there we are. Thank you very much. If you have a carnation, sit down, please, so the kids know that they can just give them. How about up in the choir loft? Can you take them to the ladies up in the choir over there? They need some. Go take them to the ladies who are standing. Can you give one to each of those ladies back there? All the way in the back. Very good. There's some. Take them all. Yep. You think we're going to get rid of all of them today? Let's see if you could take them to some of the ladies. You need another one. Let's see if there's anybody else left. Does everybody, we need one back here. We need a couple back here. Back on that side. If they're standing up. Good. Okay, and if you have extras, then bring their extras back to me and we'll put them back in the vase, okay? Thank you. Now, I would like to have one other mother stand especially today, and that is Nordine, because it is Nordine's birthday today. And it's our custom to sing happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Let's sing together. Happy birthday to you. That's a great tradition, isn't it? Now let's sit back and enjoy our choir, who's going to favor us with an anthem this morning. Edwin, come and lead the choir. Edwin. It is only by the blood of Jesus that we find freedom in him, and it is only in Jesus that we can be united from all over the world as we gather in our uniqueness and diversity in the name of Jesus Christ. And it is he that we come to worship today. It's an opportunity for us now to pause, to bring our gifts before our Lord. I'll ask our ushers to come forward at this time to receive our morning gifts. I want to remind you, especially those of you who are visiting with us, we do not expect you to contribute to this offering. These are the commitments that we've made as a congregation to carry on our ministry together, and we're delighted and really honored that you've chosen to be with us today. But it's an opportunity for us to return to the Lord some of what he has first given to us. So may we pray together. Lord, we thank you for the bounty of your gifts to us that we've seen through mothers and fathers and others and in the rich earth around us. And we thank you for jobs and for opportunities that we have in our country that others do not have around the world. We recognize that all that we are and all that we have comes initially from you. And we pause for these few moments to return some of this back to you for the advancement of your kingdom here in our world. We give you our lives as well. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. You may be seated, and I invite all of our children to leave now for junior church. We're so thankful for all of you, and we're glad we have the opportunity for you to meet together during the rest of our worship service. We'll see you all later. Be careful going down the stairs. We are going to come to a time of prayer as a congregation, and I call your attention to the prayer list that is in the bulletin in front of you. There are some of special announcements about prayer concerns that I want to bring to you this morning. We want to be praying for our mothers, of course, today. On our prayer list for many months has been Ernest Jones, who is the executive minister of the American Baptist Churches of Ohio. He's still recovering from surgery and getting back on his feet, but let's be praying for he and his wife, Denise. Hitler is still recovering from his hip surgery a couple of weeks ago. We want to make sure that we have him on our prayer list. And for Sam, who is with us, and Brenda, who is with us, and Peg, who has had some cancer removed from her face, there are some in our midst, even this morning, who need our continued and ongoing prayers. We pray for them. Please be in prayer for Pastor George and Linda as they make their way back, both today and tomorrow from South Carolina, from his brother's funeral. You'll notice on the back of the prayer list that Marty Winters passed away with 70 years of age. He's been sick for quite a while, and his death has been expected for a long while, but the family was able to gather in South Carolina. We want to be praying for them as well during these times of recovery. We want to be praying for a situation very close to home this morning as well, within a stone's throw of here. The Pine Kirk Care Center in Kirkersville, as you know, on Friday morning, was visited by a gunman by the name of Thomas Hartless, who shot two of the employees to death. He was killed, and the police chief, Stephen Desario, was also killed. He was only 36 years of age and leaves behind five children and a wife who is carrying a sixth. This is going to be a very difficult Mother's Day for her. And let's pray for that situation, for the trouble and the violence that we see in our world, especially as it touches us close to home. We're going to spend just a few moments in silent prayer. Bring these concerns and your own concerns that you have before our Lord, and then I will lead us in our pastoral prayer. Let's pray together at this time. Our Father, we look around us at the glory of your creation, the world which so stimulates and inspires us. We look at our lives and our homes, for those who have preceded us, for our mothers who have been and who are now still living in our world and in our lives. We thank you for their witness and influence on this special day that we recognize them. We also recognize all the bounty that we enjoy in our country. We know that the world is not perfect and humanity is not perfect. And as we look around us in the midst of our joy and peace and the bright sunshine, we also see so much darkness. We pray for the Winters family as they have lost their oldest brother. Pray for all of the siblings, for George and Linda, as they make their way back here. Give them safe journey. But we know that the impact that a loss makes on a family, we pray that you will bless them through these days of transition and the loss of Marty. We thank you for the promise of eternal life and that he is at home with you there. But we go on without him, and we pray that you will bless them. We pray for the situation in Kirkersville, and especially for the Desario family, for this mother and large family and the newborn who is yet to come. We pray for a sense of peace and your grace in their home and in their lives as they have lost their husband and father. We pray for the family of this shooter as well. We know that they're facing confusion and heartache today. We pray that you will work in their lives as well. We know that you have the power to change our world and to change our lives and to change the lives of those around us, because Jesus came to do exactly that. And so as we worship together here in this quiet, secure place, so we pray that as we leave here, we may be bearers of your light and peace, to be salt to a world that is so desperately in need of a new taste. We give you our lives for that and pray that you will bless us as we continue to worship together and as we hear a special word from you today. May you impact and influence our lives in unexpected ways, because we have been here today to bring our lives before you. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, I'm delighted today that the second string includes one of the greatest mothers in the world who happens to be a member of our congregation. I speak from experience, and I know that there are some wonderful, great mothers in this church, but this one is the best. The text that she's going to be speaking from is Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 5 to 9, if you would like to follow along. This is the contemporary English version that I'll be sharing with you. These few verses from Deuteronomy 6 that are familiar to all of us, we find these words that come from the inspired and authoritative written word of God for us. The Lord says, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your strength. And you must commit yourselves wholeheartedly to these commands that I'm giving you today. Repeat them again and again to your children. Talk about them when you're at home and when you are on the road, when you're going to bed and when you're getting up. Tie them to your hands and wear them on your forehead as reminders. Write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. May God add his blessing of this portion of his written word for us today. And may we just pray briefly as we await the word from our Lord. Father, we offer ourselves to you now with open minds and open hearts, that we may receive what you have for each of us as we come before you. In the name of Jesus, our Lord, we pray. Amen.
Yeah, go sit down.
Welcome to the pulpit.
After the worship, the other husbands can have 5 minutes of rebuttal about who's the best mother in this. I'm glad that George and Linda were able to go to South Carolina to be with their family members as they celebrate Marty's life, and that George was able to do the service. And in spite of those circumstances, I'm always glad to fill the pulpit here, right here among my church family. Some of you know that Dave and I have two older adult sons, but you may not know that they are only 11 months apart. Now, I would think having twins or triplets would be hard work, but next to that is having two that are very close together. You know, as one got out of a stage, the other one went right into it, and what one didn't think of, the other one thought of. One day I walked into the room that they shared as little boys, and they were both standing in Nathan's crib. Nathan's the younger one, and Matthew had his leg over the side of the crib, and he's saying, "See, Nathan, this is how you get out." But there's another day that is etched forever in my memory. It was a Saturday morning, and I was getting ready to have a monthly birthday brunch for the women of the church that we served in Southern California. And I was waiting for my mother to come pick up the boys, which she did for me every month. Everything was ready to go, but as I'm doing last-minute things, I realized that two little boys were being very quiet, which always spells trouble. So I went in search for them, and I found them in the dining room, Nathan with his hand in the butter, and Matthew with his hand in the sugar bowl with the sugar all over the table. Well, I grabbed the two of them and took them into the bathroom and cleaned them up and sent them to their room while I went back into the dining room to clean up the table. Then I heard screaming coming from their bedroom, so I rush in there to see Matthew holding the baby powder canister and Nathan's head liberally doused with the white powder. I meted out punishment to Matthew, took Nathan into the bathroom, and then as I was heading back down the hallway to our bedroom, out of the corner of my eye, I saw something in the living room, and when I turned, it was Matthew holding one of my houseplants. He was holding it like this with the pot on the floor and dirt all over the floor. So I got out the vacuum cleaner and I vacuumed that up, and then I went on to do what I was going to do in our bedroom, only to discover Nathan standing in front of my dresser with a tube of lipstick and lipstick all over his face. Fortunately, my mother arrived just then, or I wouldn't be here today to tell you that story. Parenting is not easy. You know, there are moments of sheer joy interspersed with moments of total insanity. And every generation has a fad of how we should raise children. We've gone from children should be seen and not heard, all the way to Johnny should be able to do whatever he wants to express himself, and everything in between. You can go to school to learn to do and be just about anything. You go to school to be a doctor, a lawyer, a teacher, a nurse, a singer, a dancer. There's even clown college. But you can't go to school to learn how to be a good parent. Oh, you can take workshops and you can read books, many of which are very good and helpful, but there's no right answers. There's no one way to raise children. But as Christian mothers and parents, we have the advantage of relying on God and his guidance in raising our children. I think there's a special relationship between a child and a mother. I'm not saying it's better than with a father, but it's different. Because many times children spend more time with mothers, especially in those early years. And mothers do teach us things right from day one. Here are some of the things that mothers teach us. Mothers teach us logic. If you fall off that swing and break your neck, you can't go to the store with me. Mothers teach us about medicine. If you don't stop crossing your eyes, they're going to stay that way. They teach us to think ahead. If you don't pass your spelling test, you're not going to get a good job. Mothers teach us intuition. Put your sweater on. Don't you think I know when you're cold? They teach us humor. When that lawnmower cuts off your toes, don't come running to me. They teach us how to become an adult. If you don't eat your vegetables, you'll never grow up. Mothers teach us about our ancestry. What? Were you born in a barn? Mothers teach us about religion. You better pray that comes out of the carpet. They teach us about foresight. Make sure you wear clean underwear in case you're in an accident. They teach us about contortionism. Will you look at the dirt on the back of your neck? And mothers teach us about weather. It looks as if a tornado swept through your room. And mothers teach us about justice. One day, you'll have kids, and I hope they turn out just like you do, and then you'll see what it's like. While there is no handbook for being a parent, the Bible does give us examples of godly parents. And this morning, I would like us to look at five mothers who show us how to be godly parents. The first one is found in Exodus, the first chapter of Exodus, but she's unnamed in Exodus. But in Numbers 26, we learn her name is Jochebed. Now, let me give you a little history before this. This is a time when Joseph and his brothers are long gone, and there's a new Pharaoh in town, and he doesn't know about Joseph or his brothers. He doesn't know the story. All he sees is there are all these Jewish people, and they are multiplying, and he is afraid that one day they're going to rise up and take over. So what does he do? He enslaves them, and he gives them hard labor to do. But they continue to flourish and multiply. So then he tells the midwives, okay, when you go to a Jewish birth, if it's a baby boy, you kill them. Don't let that baby be born. Well, the midwives feared God, so they wouldn't do that. So when the Pharaoh asked them, you know, why, what happens, they said, oh, well, by the time we get there, the babies are already born because these Jewish women are so hardy. So finally, he makes a decree that any Jewish boy that is born is to be thrown into the Nile. Girls can live, but the boys get thrown into the Nile. Now enters Jochebed into our story. She has a baby boy, and she knows what she's supposed to do with him, but she hides him. Now, she can't do that for very long, and so finally she realizes she needs to do something. And so you know the story. She makes a basket with tar and pitch. She puts the baby in it, hides the baby in the reeds of the Nile, and then stands her daughter Miriam as watch. And pretty soon, the Pharaoh's daughter and her entourage come walking down the river. They're bathing. And the Pharaoh's daughter must have heard the baby crying, and so she finds the basket, opens it, and she recognizes that this is a Hebrew baby. Well, just then Miriam pops out and says, would you like me to find a Jewish woman to nurse this baby? And she says, yes. So, of course, Miriam goes and gets her mother and the baby's mother. And the Pharaoh's daughter says to her, I want you to nurse this child, and I will pay you for it. So Jochebed gets to be able to take her own baby back and spend probably the first 3 years with him. But then she gives him back to the Pharaoh's daughter for her to raise as her own. And it's the Pharaoh's daughter that gives him the name Moses, which means drawn out of the water. Now, we know that Moses went on to become the person that God chose to lead his people out of Egypt and to the promised land. So here we see a mother who protected her child so that God could use him for something. Now, Jochebed had no idea at the time how God was going to use Moses. And we don't know how God is going to use our children. But we are called to do all that we can so that he can work in their lives. Now, the second mother is Hannah, which her story is found in 1 Samuel. Now, Hannah was married to Elkanah. And he also had another wife, Peninnah. Now, Peninnah had given Elkanah many children, boys and girls. But Hannah was childless. And in that society, the most important thing that you could do for your husband was to give him children, particularly boys, so that they could carry on the family line. So you can imagine that Hannah was ridiculed, and she was looked down upon in the society. And it even tells us that her sister wife did that to her, ridiculed her, laughed at her, so much so that Hannah wept and she couldn't eat. Well, every year, the family went up to the temple in Shiloh. And one year they went, and Hannah was in the temple, and she was praying, crying out to the Lord, "Please give me a child, please give me a son. And if you do, I will give him back to you to serve you for the rest of his life." Well, she wasn't actually saying these words out loud, but her lips were moving. And Eli, the priest, saw this, and he thought she was drunk. So he went over and, you know, probably patted her and said, dear, you need to give up the bottle. And she assures him, "I'm not drunk." And then she tells him about her plight and her prayer. And he says, "God be with you. You go and may he answer your prayer." Well, we know the story. God did. And she gave birth to a son. She named him Samuel, which means God has heard. And she had him at home with her for the first 3 years, and then she went back to Shiloh, and she went to Eli, and she said, "I'm that woman who stood before you a few years ago, telling you that I was asking God for a child, and he granted me this son. And I told him that if I had a son, I would give him back, and he would serve him for the rest of his life." And so she left him with Samuel. And we know the story of Samuel, that God called him at a very young age, and he became one of the great judges and prophets in Israel. Well, we see a mother here who gave her child to God. Now, we might say today we want to give our children to God, but then we don't hand them over to Pastor George to raise for the rest of their lives. But we do something similar when we have a baby dedication. You know, parents come and they bring their child and they dedicate their child to God, and then they dedicate themselves to bring up that child in the knowledge of the Lord until they are at an age where they can make their own personal decision. Well, next we have two mothers who appear together in Paul's second letter to Timothy. Eunice was Timothy's mother, and Lois was his grandmother. And Paul says to Timothy in that letter, "I know your grandmother, and I know that her faith is authentic, and I've seen that same faith in your mother, and as I've watched you, Timothy, I'm convinced of your faith also." And the word that Paul uses to describe that faith literally means without hypocrisy. So Lois and Eunice showed Timothy an authentic faith. So how did they do it? Well, Paul says they taught him scriptures from the time he was a baby. Because scripture is God's powerful tool to influence our children's lives for good. And so Paul says to Timothy that you are to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And he teaches them that we teach our children all of the scriptures that we know that we can impart to them so that they will grow in an authentic faith. Timothy was grounded in the faith from a young age by his mother and a grandmother. And the word grandmother only appears once in scripture, and it's in this verse. And everything we know about these two women is in this one verse. So that's a living memorial to mothers and grandmothers who led their child to God. One day, four ministers were talking, and as usual, conversation turned to shop talk. And the first one said, "You know, I really prefer the King James Version of the Bible for its eloquent use of the English language." And the second one said, "Well, you know, I like the New American Standard because of its faithfulness to the original Greek and Hebrew text." And then the third one said, "Well, I like the New International Version for its contemporary language and its readability." And then there was a pause, and they kind of looked at the fourth guy, and then he said, "Well, actually, I prefer my mother's translation." And they looked a little confused, and one of them finally said, "We didn't know that your mother translated the Bible." And he said, "Oh, yes, she did, every day. And because of her faith, she led me to the Lord." What greater joy and tribute could there be to a mother or a grandmother or a parent to know that your child says, "You led me to the Lord"? The last mother I want to talk about is named Evelyn. Now, you won't find her in the Bible because she was my mother. My mother was raised in a Christian home, and her parents instilled in her Christian values. And so in turn, I had a solid spiritual foundation laid in my life. My mother lived her faith every day, and prayer undergirded everything that she did. I had a brother who was 2 years older than me, who was stricken with polio at the age of 7. And I still have this very vivid mental picture of my mother about a day or two after Paul was paralyzed from the neck down and being kept alive in an iron lung. The picture in my mind is of my mother on her knees next to her bed in prayer. And it wasn't until I became a mother myself that I understood the agony she must have been going through. But the only thing I ever saw was how her faith sustained her. She was a wonderful teacher, and she taught an adult Sunday school class in every church that my father served. She was a great Bible study leader and speaker. She was my role model for a Christian woman, for a pastor's wife, for a woman in ministry. And she was also a role model for others, including Linda Swain, who has told me that as a young pastor's wife in Southern California, my mother was her mentor and role model. As mother of a disabled child, she gave up a lot of her life to care for my brother, who needed help being washed and dressed and fed. She gave up her own plans and dreams to do what needed to be done, and yet I never saw her complain or shirk from those responsibilities. When my brother was finally able to move out on his own, and that's another story in itself for another sermon, my mother started volunteering in a low-income housing ministry in Southern California that later evolved into a full-time ministry job for her. My mother modeled her faith in God by word and example. The scripture that Dave read to us this morning from Deuteronomy, the verses right before that, Moses has just reminded the Israelites that they were to keep God's commandments when they finally went into the promised land. And then verse 5 that Dave read is the commandment that Jesus said was the greatest commandment. That was to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and all your strength. And then he goes on and talks about, you know, you are to impress this on your children in any way you can, when you stand up, sit down, go to sleep, wake up, in every way, any way, all the time, we are to impress this on our children. Perhaps you still have children at home. Maybe you're a grandparent, or you have a niece or a nephew, or a special young person in your life. Well, here's some things that you can do for them. You can share with them your faith and why it's important to you. Share with them why it would be important for them to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Share your favorite Bible verses. It's Mother's Day. If your mother is still living, go beyond giving her a card or flowers today and talk to her about your faith and the part that she may have played in bringing you to faith. If your mother doesn't share your faith, then tell her why yours is important to you. And if your mother is no longer here, you can still thank God for her. But perhaps your mother was not a good role model for you, and maybe there was someone else in your life who filled that role. Thank her and thank God. How are you influencing others? You don't have to be a mother or a grandmother or even a parent, because God calls all of us to be faithful so that we can leave good footprints. There's a wonderful song entitled "Find Us Faithful." I want you to listen to these words. "We're pilgrims on the journey of the narrow road, and those who've gone before us line the way, cheering on the faithful, encouraging the weary, their lives a stirring testament to God's sustaining grace. Surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run the race not only for the prize, but as those who've gone before us, let us leave to those behind us the heritage of faithfulness passed on through godly lives. After all our dreams have come and gone, and our children sift through all we've left behind. May the clues that they discover and the memories they uncover become the light that leads them to the road we each must find. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe, and the lives we live inspire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. Just like Jochebed, Hannah, Eunice, Lois, and Evelyn, we are called to protect our children so that God can use them. We are to give them to God and to help lead them to Him and then model faith to Him, to them. My prayer today is that all who come behind will find us faithful. Let us pray. Lord, thank you for those in our lives who have cared for us and protected us, who have led us to you and shown us you through their lives. And may we in turn do the same for others. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Our closing hymn is a wonderful hymn that follows this theme entitled, Make Me a Blessing. Listen to the words as you sing it. We're going to sing all three verses of hymn number 569. Let us stand. My life, may Jesus shine. Make me a blessing, oh Savior, I pray. Make me a blessing to some. I don't know if that was a new song to you or just too high. That does go up high. Listen to these words from Proverbs 31. Charm is deceptive and beauty disappears, but a woman who honors the Lord should be praised. Let's pray. Lord, may we go back into the world, to our homes, our families, our jobs, and our schools to model Christ and help us to reflect him in all that we say and do so that others will see Jesus in us. We pray this in his name. Amen. Amen. Go in peace and happy Mother's Day. Amen.